Here we are starting our discussion with electrophoretic techniques. In analytical techniques or bioanalytical techniques, this technique is having a very immense importance, and somehow it makes it the fundamental technique, one of the fundamental techniques of the analytical biochemistry. Now, if you talk about the general principle, so actually if you talk about the term electrophoresis, it describes the migration of charged particle under the influence of electric field. So first thing is there, it is depending, it is somehow putting the charged particle to migrate, and it is actually being done under the influence of electric field. Now, if you talk about molecules like amino acids, peptides, proteins, or what you can say polypeptide, nucleotides and nucleic acids, all these biomolecules possess ionizable groups. So when I'm saying ionizable groups, it means they can be either, we can say, positively charged or negatively charged. So these molecule either normally or at any particular pH exist in charged species, either may be cationic or it may be anionic. Cationic means if we say positively charged, or anionic, it means somehow negatively charged. So it means if you are doing the electrophoresis, this technique can be applied on these particles. Now, under the influence of electric field, the charged particles migrate either to cathode or to anode. Here we need to understand, cathode is actually a negative electrode. So if you talk about the cations that are positively charged, cations, positively charged ions, move towards cathode, that is negative electrode. And then we can say anions that are negatively charged move to anode, that are positively charged electrode. So simply they move towards the opposite charge. Cationic molecules move towards cathode, anionic molecule move towards anode, positively charged molecule move towards negative electrode, negatively charged molecule move towards positive electrode. So this is actually depending on the nature of their net charge. Net charge is important because if I am saying during the procedure, if there is change in pH, there is a chance of change in net charge. This is something important to understand. Now, if you talk about the general procedure, we can see that there are two basic items which is having. It's a power pack and an electrophoresis unit. Power pack actually supplies the electricity, it can control the electricity, we can stop or start the electricity through this, and there is an electrophoresis unit where the actual electrophoresis is performed. So now we can see, this is a simple figurative representation. It is a power supply, and this is the electrophoresis unit. Now if I see that from one point there is a positive electrode, on other point there is negative electrode, we are applying the sample depending on the nature. Now if we say if particle is positively charged, it can be applied towards the positive electrode so that it should migrate towards the negative electrode. If particle is negatively charged, because this setup is somehow representing the electrophoresis of nucleic acid which are negatively charged. So here we can say that we can apply it towards the negative electrode so that they should migrate towards the positive electrode, and during the process of migration they should be separated. And now here we are seeing that this is something which is actually something like a gel. We have to be very concentrating on this thing, because this is the only reason, this is the most important reason that actually achieves the separation. Movement is because of the electricity, but separation is because of the gel. We will see this thing, and we have to discuss this thing in detail. Now here it is the actual representation. We can see these are the trays, and here we are putting the gel formation, and it we can kept. Power pack is not shown here. Now if we say there are two types of gel system, one is vertical gel system, another is horizontal gel system. Now if you talk about the vertical gel system, so these are actually, or we can say routinely, or we can say traditionally used for the separation of proteins in acrylamide gels or polyacrylamide gels. this is how we can see this is a vertical unit, and we can see that here we can put the gel, and the migration is somehow from top to bottom. Now it is actually what we do, we have to understand gel is formed between two glass plates, and these glass plates are separated by the plastic spacer. Now if you talk about the glass plates, there is a mini gel apparatus which we can see that gel dimensions are typically 8.5 cm into 5 cm. This is the mini gel apparatus, and the thickness is 0.5 mm, means half of the mm, roughly half of the mm. So the gel is actually, if you talk about 8.5 into 5 into 0.51, this is the actual volume of the gel. Now if you say there is a plastic comb which is placed in the gel solution, and it is removed after the polymerization. We have talked about that there is acrylamide which is converted to polyacrylamide. We will be discussing all these things in much detail, but right now we have to understand the general procedure. And this comb is actually made such a way that it can put 10 samples here. Now we can see this is somehow, it is actually having more, but it is depending on the gel system. But right now we can say that this is how the, so in between these plates, there are small plates, the gel is formed, and then before the formation of gel, we are putting the comb here so that during the polymerization, there should be proper formation of the wells, because when once the gel is polymerized, it is actually not changing the shape, so the well are maintained intact, and these wells are used for the loading of the sample. Now we can see there is a lower electrophoresis tank buffer that surrounds the gel plates, and this buffer actually first of all plays as a role of buffer and also affords some cooling of the gel plates. Now we can see this is somehow, this is the upper tank buffer, this is the lower tank buffer, and this lower tank buffer is in contact with this plate, so the plate which is kept in here, and so that it can afford some cooling. Now if you say this, the gel is cast on the plate of glass or plastic sheet, and it is placed on the cooling plate, and this is an insulated surface through which the cooling water is passed to conduct away the generated heat. So mainly the water or the buffer which is being used here can be used as a cooling or a coolant. Now we can see there is a connection between the gel and electrode buffer is made. It is called as a VAD. It may be a wetted filter paper, so that there should be a proper contact of upper tank buffer, because this lower tank buffer is in contact with the lower portion of the gel, but obviously we have to make the contact of the upper portion, so we use some sort of a VAD here so that there should be proper contact of this upper tank buffer with the gel. Now this procedure for the horizontal gel system is quite easy. It is the agarose gel which is used for the DNA electrophoresis, and it is run in the submerged buffer. Submerged means it is completely dipped in the buffer. In earlier case we have seen the vertical. So in vertical system we cannot keep the gel completely dipped. It is upper tank buffer and lower tank buffer on which there is connection between the both sides. But here we can see that agarose gel, it is completely dipped in the buffer, and there is a power pack supplies a direct current between the electrodes of the electrophoresis unit. We have already seen this thing, so we can understand, because this type of gel separation system is actually for the DNA isolation. Now we can understand, if you just remember the structure of the DNA, it is actually negatively charged, uniformly negatively charged, unexceptionally, means there is nothing like which some species DNA may be positive. It's not possible that it is always the negative charge. So it means the separation of the DNA is always done on the same principle. Now it is the actual procedure. We can see the actual electrophoresis tank. Now here we can see the, because in earlier case the comb was put like that because it was made in the length of the gel. Here in earlier case in vertical electrophoresis, because the gel was very thin, we are not expecting that we are putting the well in such a way that it is actually in perpendicular or throughout the thickness. But here we are making this system in the thickness. So, but obviously there should be some sort of thickness we are expecting and a proper thickness, it may be approximately half of the centimeter or 7 mm, something like that, so that there should be the proper formation of the well. Now, next part is the buffer. Buffer is very important, essential to maintain the constant state of ionization of the molecule being separated. Now, unlike the normal electricity flow, here the ions that are present inside the buffer are actually used for the, what you can say, particle that are carrying the charge. So if I'm saying there is less ions, so obviously the conduction of electricity will be less. So that is why we are using a buffer, in spite of just using a water or something like that, we are using the buffer for the maintenance of constant state of ionization. Now, if I'm saying if there is any variation in pH, because earlier we have talked about, and later cases we will discuss this thing in much detail, that how the pH is actually affecting the charge. But here one point you have to to understand, you have to pin up in your mind, that the pH can affect the overall charge of the molecule, especially in the case of protein. This is very important, that you have to maintain the pH. So that's why, in spite of using any acid or base, we are using a buffer. Buffer is having a separate category. So first of all, it maintains the overall charge, and second, it maintains the mobilities or the rate of migration in the applied field. Now, here we need to understand this point. Now, here if you talk about the equations, so we have to remember a bit of earlier physics. So if I'm saying we are having a distance d between the two electrodes, and we are applying the voltage V. For example, you can understand, suppose there is a 10 centimeter difference between the two electrodes, and we are applying the voltage 100 volt to that. Now, if you talk about there is electric field strength E. So it will be E is equal to V upon T. So now, this we have to understand, that if you talk about this variation, suppose if you are increasing the V, it will overall increase the E. If you are increasing the voltage, it will overall increase the potential gradient of E, or electric field strength of E. If we decrease the D, it will increase E. Vice versa, if we decrease the V, it will decrease the E. If we decrease the D, it will again increase the E. So we have to understand this thing, that decreasing or increasing V and D will affect the potential gradient. So now, if you talk about this potential gradient or the strength, if you talk about the force depending on the charge of the particle. So what does it mean? Suppose if I am applying E potential gradient, and there are two particles having Q and 2Q. So, but obviously for the first particle, the force will be E into Q, EQ, and if we talk about the second particle, the force will be E into 2Q, that will be 2EQ. Now, this have to understand, that the force which is being applied to the particle is actually the reason, that's why the particle moves. So, suppose if I am taking a particle which is electrically neutral, which is having no net charge on that, in that case, there will be no force on that electric particle. Even if you are applying V, even there is a potential gradient E, but if the particle is having no charge, there will be no movement. All the movement that is happening because of the charge is particle is possessing. So that's why we are saying there is a movement of charged particle into the electric field. Now, second point, there is the frictional resistance. This is the most important force in the electrophoresis. That is why we have talked about that. That is why we are having gel. And actually, there are many reasons other than gel, and that can provide the frictional resistance. So frictional resistance actually retards the movement of this charged particle. Now, how we can say that this frictional resistance is decided? Hydrodynamic size of the molecule. Obviously, if a particle is small, it will have less frictional resistance. If it is large, or if it becomes large when it is coming under the water, it will be retarded. shape of the molecule. We can understand if a molecule is fluffy in nature or disorganized in nature, it will be facing more resistance because of higher expansion. If same molecule is organized in nature, it will be having less friction. Pore size of the electrophoretic medium. Now we can understand this thing because it's a gel, and this gel is actually providing certain type of pores. The molecules pass through these pores, and when they are being there is a small pore, it will be difficult for a small molecule or even for a large molecule to pass through that. The smaller molecule may be quite swift to pass, but the larger molecule will be having more resistance. So smaller the pore size, greater will be the frictional resistance. And finally, the viscosity of the buffer. Obviously, if the buffer is viscous, it will be creating more resistance. It means, suppose if we are taking something buffer which is having higher concentration, it will be putting more resistance. If a buffer is having low concentration, it will be putting less. So that is why the concentration of buffer can also be provider of the frictional resistance. Now we have to talk about that velocity of a charged molecule is actually E into Q, that is the force upon frictional resistance. Now if you consider E into Q as a single unit, so V is proportional to 1 upon F, or V is what you can say inversely proportional to the frictional resistance. Now this we have to understand, it means higher the frictional resistance, in spite of having a charge, there will be lesser movement. Lower the frictional resistance, movement will be higher. Now it means if I am saying frictional resistance, if the size is higher, movement is less. If the shape is disorganized or fluffy, movement is less. If pore size is small, movement is less. If viscosity of the buffer is higher, movement is less. So it means this is what we can say overall determinant of the movement of the particle. Now if we can say V upon E, so this is actually we can say it is called as electrophoretic mobility, although this we need not to be too much discussive about, but V upon E. So what we can say, if I am saying electrophoretic mobility, now there should be a point of confusion. If I am saying how the electrophoretic mobility is inversely proportional to the electric field strength. Now if we just put the earlier equation, if I am putting this V upon E, so I am bringing this term here, so it will be Q upon F. So in spite of focusing on this part, that it is talking about the velocity and electric field strength, if I am saying mu is equal to V upon E is equal to Q upon F. Now we can understand this electrophoretic mobility in a better way. Q upon F, higher the charge, higher will the mobility. F, higher the friction, lower will the mobility. So if you talk about this, instead of putting a term Q upon F, you can simply see V upon E. Why? Because these two terms are quite easy to understand. You can easily observe the movement of the particle. So we can say how it is moving and what is the velocity of the movement, and we can simply see what is exactly the electric field strength. So determining Q upon F will be a bit difficult, maybe a bit difficult. So we just simply put these terms as V upon E. Now, when we apply the potential difference, molecules with different charges will begin to move differently or separating, and it is actually depending on the electrophoretic mobility. Now we need not to confuse that there is only one thing which we are talking about, that it is only the charge is different. If there is higher friction, the movement will be hindered. If there is lower friction, the movement will be unhindered, and the friction will be depending on all the four factors which we have talked about. And at least we can see size and shape of the molecule will be of prime importance, because for all the molecule, the pore size of the electrophoretic medium will be constant, the viscosity of buffer will be constant. So finally, the hydrodynamic size of the molecule and the shape of the molecule will be the decisive factor for the movement of the particle or electrophoretic mobilities. Now, if you talk about the molecule with similar charges, so even they will be what you can say separate, but if they have different molecule size, different molecular size, higher molecular size, higher will be the friction. Finally, higher molecular size molecule will be facing more friction, and how it is going to be have what you can say, both of these particle will face the different frictional forces. And now there may be what you can say, if there are two molecules which are having different charges, suppose if you talk about proteins may have different charges, so again they will be separated on the basis of their charge. So we can understand, higher the charge, higher will be the mobility, lower the charge, lower will be the mobility. So not only the frictional force, charge is also the decisive factor. Now if we say there is difference in molecular size, and then it will actually different separation rate, means obviously if a molecule is having smaller molecular size, it will be small. If a molecule is having different higher molecular size, it will be big, and how they are being separated because of the different frictional forces. Now after the separation, we remove the electrical field. But there is one thing which we have to understand, that if we talk about earlier technique which has gone through in junior classes, that we actually allow the molecule to reach the electrodes. Here we don't allow the molecule to reach the electrode, we actually remove the electrofield before the molecule in the sample reach the electrodes, and now they are being separated by their electrophoretic mobility. So if you talk about the electrolysis, in which we allow the molecule to reach the electrodes, this is called as complete form. But here, because we don't allow the molecule to reach their concerned electrodes, this is called as incomplete form of electrolysis. We can simply say this as incomplete form of electrolysis. Now there are different methods how we can see. There may be something what you can say staining. We with the dye, we can see them. There is one technique called autoradiography, which we will discuss in our last unit. Here we can go for the radio labeling, and there are other methods also. Now there is other thing which we have to understand. Suppose if you are increasing the electric field, if you are increasing the voltage, overall we will be increasing the potential difference, and overall it may increase the process of separation. This is important to understand, that can we achieve a higher rate of separation by increasing the voltage? Yes, answer is yes, that we can achieve the higher rate of separation by increasing the voltage. Now along with that, there is a problem that even or if we are increasing, we can not ignore the generation of heat. Reason being, there is certain wattage which is being produced, and that wattage will eventually lead for the generation of heat. So we can understand simply thing, V upon I is equal to IR, or V is equal to what you can say, this is what we understand, the basic equation of the Ohm's law. And here we can understand that even if we are having this wattage, wattage is called as I square R. So there will be different, there will be certainly a current here, and it will eventually lead for the formation of a power, and that power will ultimately convert into the heat. Some amount of that power will be converted to heat. So this is somehow we can say somehow unavoidable process of the generation of heat, generation of electrophoresis. Now these power is mostly converted as heat. Now problem is, what are the effects of the heat? There will be some increased rate of diffusion. Now we have to understand things, this thing, since very very beginning, that diffusion is always a process that is actually discouraged. Reason being, it is bidirectional, means it may be happening in the direction of separation, and it may be happening in the opposite direction of the separation, and again it may be happening what you can say in three dimensional space. So what will do, it will actually broader the separated samples. we are not expecting that when we are separating the sample, they are going to be in a broader, it should be concise in a single band, it should not be spread. Now, there is another problem, is the formation of convection current. Actually, it is happening in the, what we can say, in the vertical direction of the movement. So, what is going to happen because of this, it will be causing the mixing of separated samples. Now, there may be thermal instability. Next factor, some sample may be quite sensitive for the heat, and this may cause the denaturation of the proteins. Although in majority of the cases, if we are only concerned about the separation of protein, we use denaturating condition. But suppose if we want the enzyme to be in active form, suppose if we want the enzyme to be like protein to be behaving like enzyme, in that case it will be compromised. And second, if we increase the temperature, there will be decrease in the buffer viscosity. Buffer viscosity is actually playing very important role in the creation of the resistance of the media, and because of the decreased buffer viscosity, there will be reduction in the resistance of media. So overall, these are the four factors. Again, I am saying, increase the rate of diffusion, convection currents for the mixing of sample, thermal instability, denaturation of protein, and decreased buffer viscosity, reduction in the resistance of the media. These are the four factors. So now, how can we counter? First of all, we can go for the constant voltage. We can use for the established power supply, means we should not be varying the voltage in between, and this is somehow, it is not actually eliminating the heat problem, it is actually eliminating the fluctuation in the heating. So there will be a constant rate of heat production. Second, we can use for the very low power supply or a low current. So now, lower the current, lower will be the production of heat. But again, there will be increased amount of diffusion because samples are having a natural tendency to get diffused. Diffusion is simply movement from higher concentration to lower concentration. So if you are putting the samples, it will be automatically go for the increased amount of diffusion. So this is the problem. So overall, there are always the compromise condition. Again, if you are putting the reasonable power setting. So what we do, we put some accepted separation time, it should not be too high, and there should be somehow what you can say cooling system or current which can say and which can be used. But overall, this is not eliminating the heat 100%.